You're listening to the audio production of Uninvited, Audio Bible Study, by Lysa TerKeurst, published by Thomas Nelson and presented by the author. The Audio Bible Studies series provides a unique audio learning experience. Unlike a traditional audiobook's direct narration of a book's text, Uninvited includes high-quality live audio sessions from the author that cover important Bible-based topics. These sessions will reflect the ambience of the unique recording locations, immersing the listener into the teaching.
Welcome to the Uninvited Study, and welcome to the Holy Land. And I couldn't be more excited. Honestly, of all the studies I've done, this one has profoundly shifted something deep inside of me. You see, the topic we're tackling in Uninvited is rejection. I wanted to know, I needed to know, can the Bible help me process the devastating feelings of being left out, lonely, less than, all those feelings of rejection? You know, rejection is such a tough emotion to deal with because it never comes as an isolated feeling. Today's rejections, big or small, they're like stealth bombs that zing straight to my core, locating hurts from my past and making them extremely present all over again. They send messages that scramble up my carefully established formulas for keeping life stable. The voices of doubt and insecurity, they whisper to me and say, "See, I've been telling you for years what an utter disappointment you are." Those voices don't have to scream, because the pain does that in deafening tones. You know, rejection, it steals the best of who I am by reinforcing the very worst that's been said to me. And it kind of just sneaks up on me time and time again. It's like I'll hop on Instagram one morning and I see that three of my close friends had dinner last night and they didn't invite me. And suddenly my mind races with reasons why. All the emotions from the rejections of my past, they sneak into these little situations of today, and suddenly they just don't feel so little anymore. Rejection lands heavy on a girl's heart and leaves the darkest marks. Like when my dad left and decided he wanted nothing to do with my sister and I. You know, it's been over 24 years since I've heard his voice. Or when I was in college, there was a guy that I thought was gonna propose to me, but instead he admitted that he had fallen in love with someone else. Rejection is harsh and hurtful and even quite haunting. So today, I wanted to start here at the Church of the Nativity in Bethlehem. This church marks the spot where they believe that the manger or the sheepfold where Jesus was born could have been located. And I want you to notice something so odd but incredibly beautiful about this church. To enter in, you must bow low. The front entrance is called the Door of Humility. Now think about that as I read this verse from Matthew 11, 28 through 29. "Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls." Rest for your soul is waiting when we bow low and come to Him and learn from Him. He is gentle and He is humble. In Him, we find all the acceptance that we've ever longed for. Well, I can't wait to share with you my absolute favorite places and the teachings that I know will help you look at rejections in your life in a whole new and honestly much more healthy way. We're gonna travel during this study to the Mount of Beatitudes. Then we're gonna go to Caiaphas's house where Peter betrayed Jesus, the cave of Adullam where David hid from Saul, Shiloh where Hannah prayed, the cliffs of Mount Arbel, and the Garden of Gethsemane, where we're gonna learn something truly unforgettable. And each week, I'm gonna be giving you a statement to hold on to that will really help you live the message that we're learning. It's gonna be a really exciting 6 weeks. It'll be a time of healing and new perspectives, a time for us to go to new places with Jesus and experience Him like never before. So, before we jump into lesson one, let me assure you of something. Rejection never has the final say. Rejection may be a delay or a distraction or even a devastation for a season, but it's never a final destination. You are destined for a love that cannot ever be diminished, tarnished, shaken, or taken. With Jesus, you are forever safe, forever accepted, forever held, completely loved, and always invited in. Welcome to Lesson 1 of Uninvited, and welcome to the Mount of Beatitudes, where Jesus preached a sermon that I'm convinced he thought of all the way back in creation. I'll say this several times while we're here in the Holy Land, but after studying John chapter 1, where we're told that Jesus was here in the beginning and through him all things were made, well, I know he set the scene for this place. This sermon in this place, it was not just an eloquent message. It was a proclamation, a declaration that today on this mountainside, I have come to announce prophecy has been fulfilled. The words you've heard me read in the synagogue from the scroll of Isaiah, they are true and they are now reality. Interestingly enough, Jesus is the first recorded proof that the prophets were read from in the synagogue. You can see this in Luke chapter 4, starting in verse 16. He reads from Isaiah 61, 1 through 2. He said, "The Spirit of the Lord is on me because he has anointed me to preach good news to the poor." And then in the middle of verse 2, he stops mid-sentence and he just sits down. Think of how awkward this would be in church today if your pastor did that. And then it says in verse 21, Jesus says, "Today, this scripture is fulfilled in your hearing." Wow, it was an earth-shaking moment for sure. At first, they accept him, and then they reject him, and then they run him out of town. Their hearts weren't ready to receive his message, so he stopped. He didn't force it, but he revisits the same theme here at the Mount of Beatitudes. And this time, it's not in a synagogue, but to simple people on a mountainside. Again, it was profound because Jesus didn't announce that he was the fulfillment of Isaiah 61 with trumpets and fanfare. No, he just simply and lovingly started, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven." Indeed, this was, as Isaiah says, good news to the poor. So turn in your Bibles to Matthew chapter 5. In Matthew chapter 5, starting in verse 1, it says this, "Now, when he saw the crowds, he went up on a mountainside and sat down. His disciples came to him, and he began to teach them, saying, 'Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called sons of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people insult you, persecute you, and falsely say all kinds of evil against you because of me. Rejoice and be glad, because great is your reward in heaven. For in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you. You are the salt of the earth. But if salt loses its saltiness, how can it be made salty again? It is no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled by men. You are the light of the world. A city on a hill cannot be hidden. Neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on its stand and it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before men that they may see your good deeds and praise your Father in heaven." And of course, he continues to go on. But listen for the music in the text as he continues in Matthew chapter 6 and Matthew chapter 7. So fascinating. If you look over at Matthew chapter 6, starting in verse 26, I believe that Jesus would have, at this moment, it would have been springtime and the grass would have been green and the rocks they were sitting on, they would have been volcanic rocks, not sharp rocks, but they would have been rocks with soft edges. And they were comfortable. They were good seats. It was like he set the theater. He set this scene to tell his people and to tell us that the Messiah has come to live with you. And if you remain with me, you can live loved. And it's so fun. You can hear the birds now, because then I picture him cueing the birds. You see, every year there's millions of birds in the springtime that suddenly migrate right over this area. And I think that he would have cued them, migrate now. And then he would have said, Matthew 6, verse 26, look at the birds of the air. And it was like music. The birds of the air just swarmed by, millions. I mean, even to this day, if you're driving down the road and you happen to be here in the springtime when the migration happens, you'll have to pull your car over because it's so breathtakingly beautiful. He created this so he could cue it at this moment. Look at the birds of the air. And then he would have let the people look and observe and watch in wonder as they went by. And then he would have continued, they do not sow or reap or store away in barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not much more valuable than they? Verse 27, who of you by worrying can add a single hour to his life? And then there would have been lots of little kids. Now, the little kids wouldn't have been sitting on the rocks. I imagine the adults were doing that. The little kids would have been scampering around on the beautiful green grass. If you're here in the springtime, I'm telling you, it's like a green carpet, and there are these yellow mustard flowers. It's gorgeous. It's just beautiful. And I imagine that the kids were running around, and then they would come and...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.